Let us pray. We are here because you moved in us to bring us here. We many times think, oh, I decided to go to church today. No, it's you. How can we go somewhere if we do not know the place exists? How can we go and meet someone if that person is unknown to us? It's all you. You made yourself visible, not only in your creation, but also in the person of Christ. You came to us through the prophets of the Old Testament and the story of Israel in so many different ways to show the world there's a God that has a plan for humanity. Then you ask of us to meet. Not to meet each other only, but to meet with you, and that's what we are doing now. And it's all because of what you started, not only in history, but also in our own personal lives. So we thank you, Lord, for the grace that you bestowed upon us, that we may be able to say, I know who God is, and I know who this God is that cares for me. I know the path to this God, and I know that if I follow this path, I will see my dad, my Father in heaven. Thank you for making it for us so clear and so easy by doing every single thing that needs to be done for us to connect with you. Thank you, Jesus, that you came to this world and paid the sacrifice for our sins, that we may be called then the children of God. Lord, as we now enter into this amazing space that the Bible calls heaven, I ask that you will help us today as we look at your word and in it discover some of the scenes, the imagery that will help us grasp something about what lies ahead. We ask this in the name of our Lord himself, who came to this world to make it possible for us to go to this place. Amen. Heaven, that's what I'm going to talk about today. So, I started many months ago in January with the book of Revelation. And you know, in the first chapter, the first verses, starts off by saying that there are these seven lampposts, and then there's someone like the Son of Man among these lampposts. And I explained it, I think, hopefully, and well enough for you and me to know that the lampposts represents the church, the believers of Jesus Christ in this world, and then with us is Jesus. He came to this world to help us, to save us, but as he departed, he sent his Spirit to be with us, so in his Spirit, he's still with us. And I tried to explain to you that the book of Revelation is actually a book of hope. You know, a lot of people are really afraid of this book because they say, oh, it's all of these terrible things that you discover, it's the bowls of wrath and all of these things that we looked at over the months. But if, at the end of the day, it's a book of hope. Because what this book tells us is that it starts off with God with us, with Christ with us, and then it ends here at the end with we being with Christ. So here we are, he's with us, and then we end up with him, where he is. So there's this journey between him with us and we with him. With the emphasis is now changed from he with me and I with him, and that's two different places and two different kinds of settings that we find. But between these two things, there's this journey that we know that's not always that easy and it's somewhat complicated. Now, very interesting to me is that the world that we live in, you know, a lot of people do not go to church anymore and a lot of people do not believe in God anymore, do not know the commandments anymore. You can see it when you drive. We are surrounded by people who do not know God, and it seems to me they're not afraid to die, and they drive without any law or any moral code. I do not know. It's just very interesting now on the roads, I think. But even though this is true, we live in a world where people do not really believe in God, but they always want to talk about heaven. You know, if anybody dies or there's a crisis, even people who do not belong to church or, I think, read the Bible will say, oh, now they are now up there. No, I do not know if they know what up there means, but they are now smiling up there. They are happy up there. They are now, and all kinds of good things are being said about those that are now up there. So I heard this story of this pastor that died, and then all these jokes, you know, about heaven. There are countless of jokes. So the pastor died, and a taxi driver, you probably know the story, died, and they ended up in heaven, and they were allocated a dwelling place. And the taxi driver got this huge mansion, and the pastor got this really humble, you know, dwelling. And the pastor went to St. Peter. He said, I don't know, understand. Why did the taxi driver get this mansion? I got just this, like, small dwelling. He said, well, it all depends on how much you did for God's kingdom. And the pastor said, but I was a pastor all my life, and he was just a taxi driver. And St. Michael said, well, while you were preaching, they were sleeping, and while he was driving, they were praying. So, yeah. One more. So a Sunday school teacher says to the children, it's part of my sermon. A Sunday school teacher says to the class, he says, okay, if you sell all your stuff, will you then go to heaven? All the kids, no. If you go to church and you come to Sunday school, will you then go to heaven? No. She said, what do you need to go to heaven? And little Tommy in the back said, you got to die. That's the problem, isn't it? Everybody wants to go to heaven, but nobody wants to die. You know, I need to stop telling these jokes. This guy ended up, and his wife died, and then she was there, and then he died years later. And when he got there, his wife said, look how beautiful this place is, you know, all the stuff, it's just fantastic. And he stared at her, and he said, you gave me all those healthy foods all those years. I could have been here long ago. Let's find out what the Bible teaches us about heaven, and I need to stop telling jokes. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I'm not going to preach about the sea part. Just want to say the sea was always this threatening place for the Jews. They didn't like the sea. Even the Sea of Galilee, that you could see both ends when you were in the lake, was threatening to them. They didn't like being on the water. And I saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain, and that's what people so long for, will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. He also said this, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Then he said to me, it is done. I'm the Alpha, I'm the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquered will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the polluted, the murderers, the fornicators, the sorcerers, the idolaters and the liars, their place will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. Then one of the seven angels, the one who had the bowls of wrath, of plagues, came and said to me, come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And in the spirit he carried me away to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord, the God, God Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need for sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God is its light. And its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the king of the earth will bring their glory into it. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. People will bring into it glory and the honor of the nations. Nothing unclean will enter in it, nor anyone who practices abomination or falsehood, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. A few notes, and I promise you, I'd said, Louise, I'm going to shock myself by preaching a short sermon today. It's Labor Day. I can't labor on Labor Day weekend. The old is gone, the new has begun. The sea is then no more. What is this old? It's the old earth, it's the old way, it's the old life. I do not know if you know this. I'm just going to read this for you from Romans chapter 8. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not of its own, but by the will of the one who subjected it in hope. That the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and will obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. How many times have you and I turned on the TV and you've seen people abuse animals? Cruelty beyond what you and I can imagine. There's no real cruelty in nature itself. They kill and they hunt, and in the process they kill, but just to harm and to hurt for the sake of it doesn't really exist out there. And now the Bible comes and tells us that even nature, even this world, even the animals in the sense that surrounds us are groaning, are longing to be renewed because of the harm that sin and the brokenness of humankind has caused to this planet of ours and to the world around us. Now it comes and tells us the old is gone and there will be a new. So many people have asked, is this world that we now have, this planet, this blue dot that we live in, is this now going to be a part of the new heaven and the new earth? I think so. You know, God will do what he wants to do with his creation. We had a systematic professor, a theology professor, who told us, he said, I really believe that the music that was created, the beautiful music that was created, and some of the artwork, and maybe I do not know what, he said, why would God let all of those things just disappear? Maybe that's part of this new heaven, this new earth that God is going to give us, because in a sense, it's just going to be without sin, without the nonsense that we have on this planet. No weeds in the grass, if you have grass, no sweating, no all of this nonsense. But then it also talks about a new heaven. People say, well, what's wrong with heaven now? But the word here for heaven is that realm between earth and heaven. Paul comes and he says our threat in this world is not only from what we can see, but also from the spirits in the heavens above us. That is the evil that you will find. Satan and his cohorts that really tries to destroy then the good things that God has created. Now the Bible comes and tells us this is going to be done and gone. God is going to not recreate, he's going to clean, completely clean up this world from all the decay and all the issues that we have brought upon it by creating and doing sin. A second thing, no death, crying, and pain. So it's too interesting to me that it says here that God himself will wipe away our tears. How can you have tears when you are in heaven? No, it means that a lot of people will arrive in heaven with tears on their cheeks. What this wants to tell us is that God knows how hard life is for us in this world. God understands this. Countless of people have shown up in heaven, just as they were dying, but they were crying because of the pain they were going through. And God knows if there is but one thing that takes our hope and our life and our joy away, it's the concern about pain and suffering and death and dying and all of these kinds of things. You know, we are trying to create on this world, and many people try to do it, to create sort of heaven on earth. You know, by creating around them a beautiful place to live in and maybe with the best possible luxury and comfort. But you can never have heaven on earth because your body is slowly decaying and breaking down, and you are reminded inside yourself that you are not great. And therefore, so many people have so much, but in their hearts they are dead because the joy that they think they should have just missing. Now this section comes and tells us, God says, I know the suffering that you guys are going through. That's part of this brokenness in the world. You will never have heaven on earth, because if there's heaven on earth, you do not want to be in heaven that's in heaven. And when you die, you may enter into my presence for that last second with a tear in your eye because of life that's so difficult and so hard. And the God that we believe in knows this. And he says, I will be the one to wipe that tear. And then he says, it's done. It's done. No church anymore. I'm fired in heaven. There's no church. It says there's no, John says, I couldn't find a tabernacle or a tent or a dwelling place or anything for God. Why? Because this is now for us the intermediate as we connect with God. In 2001, the church called me here, and Louise and the children were still in South Africa for like 4 months before they came. Now, in 2001, communication was not that easy. So we mostly communicated via email. And I remember one Sunday I stood in the pulpit and I said to the congregation, I'm now done with email. I now need my female. I want my wife here with me. Not there. That's what the church is. This is the email section, the email part of a relationship. And God, in a way, is saying, I'm so tired of this email thing. I now need my bride, my female, to be with me. And that's actually then what happens when we die. When we die, we are connected then with our dead in completion. This is the struggling part, and the church played this role. It's this conduit for us to be able to connect with God, and it's met by God. You know, there are so many people that say, oh, church is not important. I say, good luck to you. I didn't invent church. I didn't invent my role to be a pastor in a church. I wanted to do something completely different. When I was in high school, I was heading in a science direction. You know me? You know how much I like and I love science. And God stopped me and he pointed me towards ministry. And I said, I can't do this. I'm good with science, but not with languages. And I had to get Greek and Hebrew and German and all these kinds of stuff to become a pastor. So this is God's idea of helping us in this journey that we are in until the end. Church is God's idea, but church will end in heaven. Then he says, I'm the Alpha and Omega. Oh, you hear this so many times. People know at least this phrase. It's the first letter and the last letter of the Greek alphabet, the Alpha and the Omega. And all it means is God says, I'm the one that's the beginning and the end. I'm on the beginning and the end of the creation. God created everything. That's what we believe. But it's also then the end, the process that will end. And the end here is not an end. It's just the end of our story on earth. So what he's trying to tell you is that God knew about you before you were born. God was present when you were born. When your parents were, oh, baby, God knew. He was there. When they gave you a name, God just smiled because he already ordained that. He knows. And God was with you when you started to give your first steps, and he walked with us, and he journeyed with us through our whole life. And constantly, as we grew older, he was knocking louder and louder and saying, hey, I'm here. Ooh, I'm God. I'm here. You know, your parents are important, world is important, but ooh, I'm here, just see me, I'm God. I'm the one that started your journey, and I want to be with you till the end in this journey. If you walk away from me and you constantly ignore me, your journey is going to get harder and harder and harder and more difficult because you decide to do your own thing and you don't want me to help you doing my thing and the thing that are things that are important to me. Then the bride arrives, you know, and I've done so many counters of weddings. Well, I've done many weddings, not counters, but many weddings in my many years of ministry. And I always say to Louise, when I do a wedding, I try my best because it's such an important day for the bride and the groom. You know, hopefully they only get married once, and so the day should be special. And I believe a pastor should do his best on that day because it's a moment for them. But I always, when I stand here or outside or whatever, I always look at the groom's face when the bride comes down the aisle. All the people look at the bride. He looks at the bride, but I look at his face because I will see her for a long time. She's standing right in front of me. But I look at his face, and I always see these different expressions in these guys' faces. I've seen many guys who are as tough as rock. You know, the tears would start to flow. I would some of them starting to shake of pure excitement. I would see this joy. I would see all of those extremely beautiful responses and things. The bride is coming. Your death and my death is going to be celebrated in heaven because the bride of Christ, we are the bride of Jesus. We are coming to be with him. He's tremendously, tremendously excited. But why doesn't he bring us home now? Why not now? Because he's not done yet with his work on this planet. Why do people not get married the moment when they meet each other in a coffee shop? It sometimes takes a long time for the relationship to develop. Then it's a lot of stuff that needs to be in place, and then they need to find a place. All of so part of our life story is this preparation for this meeting with the bride. And in the midst of all of this, God is also doing his work in us and through us. But man, there's this expectation. But who is it? It's for those who believe, to conquer it. Time and time again in the Bible, you'll find this. It's for those who believe, those who stood firm, who persevered. Because the world will try to drag you away from the presence of God. You know, some people say, well, if you believe in God, you are saved forever. And that's true. God will not let go of his own. But I'm always a bit concerned if that guy, that the child that walked away from his dad, you know, the prodigal son, if he died while watching the pigs, would he be saved? Why was his dad so concerned about this child that was not home anymore? Now, many times wonder if I, as a Christian, just walk away from God. Demas, that's an example in the New Testament where Paul says Demas gave up his faith and became worldly. And I'm not sure if Demas is connected anymore. Because what makes faith, faith? It's a relationship. If I would tell you today, I haven't talked to Luis for the last 5 years, do we still have a relationship? No. So faith has to do with the relationship that we need to persevere in maintaining and having with our Lord, because he's doing it from his side. Heaven is way more a person than a place. I quickly just need to move forward. So where's heaven now? You know, I point up, a guy in Australia points up, but he points in a different direction. So, of course, the earth is round. So where's heaven? Heaven is where God is. Done. Where's God? Right there. Where's right there where we can't see? We had a professor that told us once, we were sitting in class, he said, do you guys want to know where's heaven? We said, yeah. He says, it's right here. We said, what do you do when you do this? He says, right there where we cannot see. Because if God is here, we are a little bit in heaven. Because heaven has to do not with a place, but with a person. Heaven is way more about being with God than being somewhere. Even though we will be somewhere. I do not know where. It doesn't matter really what it's going to look like. All the imagery we find now in this book, in this chapter, I didn't read it. But there's a long section that explains how this New Jerusalem is going to look like. But if you go and look at the scriptures about it, it's just, they use every single imagery they've got, or John, to just explain to the readers how beautiful, magnificent, and wonderful the presence of God is. If you stand outside in Alaska of these places with these beautiful mountains or in the West Coast or wherever, and there's this beautiful sunset and mountains, you always say, oh, I feel so close to God. That's nothing in comparison to be with God in heaven. The glory of the Lord, no sun, no moon is needed, because God will be present. He will light up the sky. My second part, briefly. So that is where we are going when we die. But what happens to me when I die? Many people ask me that question. It's in the Bible, Corinthians. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. As all die in Adam, so will all be made alive in Christ. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? What kind of body do they come? That's now us. Now Paul said, fool, don't worry about these things. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen to each kind of seed its own body. For this perishable body must put on imperishability, and the mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable body puts on imperishability and the mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that it is written will be fulfilled. Death has swallowed up in victory. Big words for me to say on Labor Day weekend. Okay, quickly. What Paul says, as Jesus rose, we will rise. Why would you die for a lie? That's what the disciples, that's what made them change their lives. The coming of the Holy Spirit, and that they ran out in the streets. They were shut up in a room. too afraid to go out. They thought the Romans was going to kill them. The next moment, Peter and all these guys were standing there and said, "You can do with us whatever you want because we saw the risen Lord. We saw him killed, dead, and then we saw him." That is the story. And then in Acts, it also says, Paul writes actually in this chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians that more than 500 people saw Jesus risen. So Paul constantly says, if you believe in Jesus and you believe in his resurrection, that's what he came to do, is to tell us, I came to defeat death that you can know that you are going to live. But for us to be able to enter this heaven, to enter this place, this body, we need to get rid of this thing, because this thing is tied to this world, to gravity. Gravity is not our friend anymore as you get older, isn't it? You know, it's harder to get up. You know, you sit down, it's fantastic, getting up, your gravity. Gravity is getting worse every week for me, in the, I believe. You know, they should write about this, or it's me that's getting weaker. But okay. But we need to move away from this physical body to a spiritual body. How does this happen? I had to hide this now twice from little Eli this morning, because every time he sees my peach, he wants to eat it. Paul uses this illustration of a peach. Well, not a peach, but a seed. Look at the picture on the screen. Inside this peach, you have that seed. Inside this thing. A peach seed is not the most attractive thing there is. It looks like this. It's full of wrinkles and has a sharp point, and it's not the greatest. Paul says, this is what you have. If you look at 30 now, you will see that wrinkled thing. That's not that great. And eventually, it's sort of just this thing. But go and plant the seed. And what comes up? The peach tree. That eventually will have beautiful fruit. If you plant a peach tree, you won't have a banana tree that will come up, or a citrus tree, or an apple tree. It will be a peach tree. That's what Paul is trying to explain. He says, to you and to me, you have your own personality and your own spirit. You have the Holy Spirit in you that makes you you. So if you stand in front of a mirror and you look at yourself and you say, who am I? You're not talking about body. You're talking about what's not only in your brain, you're talking about your soul. Your soul is as unique as the seed inside the peach. When you plant this seed, what comes up is a peach tree. When I die, Paul used the illustration, it's as if you are putting something in the dirt. Of course, that's what you do when people die, put them in the dirt. But essentially, what comes up, Paul says, immediately, like this, not later on, immediately, is something that has everything about you in it, but beautiful, completely different. Because that's what we're going to be when we are in the presence of God. So what will our relationships then be in heaven? People always ask me, so will Luis and I, will we still have the same relationship there? People came to Jesus and said, okay, this guy had 7 wives, so who's going to be his wife in heaven? Aren't they going to have a bit of a fight there? The Lord said, no, you don't understand what heaven is. He didn't even answer their question. Of course, heaven has to do with God, not with us. Well, Luis and I have a relationship, yeah, but it'll be different than it is here on earth, because God's relationship will be so intense and be so overwhelming that our relationship will be a little bit more limited. Will I recognize my dad? Absolutely. I told my dad when he passed, he had mesothelioma cancer, and I sat with him a week or so before he died. I said, Dad, I'll see you in heaven, and I'll be on the east side. There's, according to the next section, I didn't read, there are all these pillars. I said, the center pillar, I'll be there. I was joking. He said, I'll see you, my son. But will he look like he looked when he was on earth? No. Will our relationship be exactly the same? No, because it'll be washed clean of all sin. It'll be perfect. And covering it all, the presence of God Almighty, the presence of Jesus Christ that walks around and smiles upon us in our relationships. Can't wait. Will my dog be there? I don't know. People ask me that question always. And I say, I don't know. There, the Bible talks about horses in heaven, but I'm not sure. I'm not sure if your dog's going to be here. Maybe. Why would God not allow? Because my first dog's name was William. You know, he was my firstborn. You know, so we didn't, you know. Black Labrador. Well, William, is he waiting for me in heaven? Maybe. I don't know. God knows I love my dog, and maybe William sits there and he waits for me. I don't know. Can't wait to see. But if he's not there, it's okay, because I'll be in the presence of God Almighty, presence of Jesus himself. What will we do in heaven? I had a few guys say to me, "Further, I can't sing. Now here we're going to sing a lot." I said, no, that's not what's going to happen. If the Bible talks about singing, it's just bringing God praises. Do you know what? When God created Adam and Eve, he created them to serve him and his kingdom. I think we're going to serve God's creation. I like to travel. I can't wait to die and to go to a different planet. I can't wait to see what's in the other side of our galaxies. I will say to the Lord, "Lord, if you want a guy to do the far off work, let me go and have a check out there and do whatever you want me to do." We're going to be a part of God's work. Because he created Adam and Eve, he says, I created you to maintain this world of mine that I've created, and I'll be in your presence." He wandered with them in the evenings, and he was there, and it was just beautiful until they messed it all up. But now with the new heaven and the new earth, we can't mess it up. It's done. There can't be sin anymore. There can't be Satan anymore, because the Bible is clear that has ended. That's now all done. Satan is now put away. They are in a different area, different space, away from God, because that's what they chose. Now, I've said this before. Remember, heaven, if you want to be with God, you can spend eternity with God. If you live your life without God, God says, "Why do you want to spend eternity with me?" Then you just go way out to where I'm not. So that's where Satan and the non-believers will go, to a place where God's not, because that's their choice. They don't want to hang out with God, so God says, "Then you go there." Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? My second last slide. Sting of death is sin. Power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we never want to think about death, because it's a depressing topic. If you really want to be a party pooper tomorrow on Labor Day, if you go for a barbecue, say, "Let's talk about death a bit." They won't like you much. But it's a reality that all of us are going to face, isn't it? It's one thing you and I will not escape. Either the second coming of Christ, or we will die. In that moment, you and I will be in front of God, in front of Christ. We will all see him. That's what the Bible tells me. But for us who sit in this church and are watching online and believe in Jesus Christ, we do not need to fear death. Of course, we are concerned about death. Of course, there's this uncertainty. Nobody really wants to die, and it's okay. That's why we do our best to stay alive, because nobody wants to die, because we're enjoying still our life here, and that's wonderful. It's fine. It's good. But what the Bible wants to tell us is not to live in so much fear for death that you lose also today. God says, "I've got it. And when that day for you comes, when that moment comes for you, I will journey with you through it. You will not be alone, because didn't I tell you? I'm with my lamppost, and you are my lamppost, and lampposts were the people who believed, the church, the bride of Christ." The way to heaven, and they said, Paul and Silas were in prison. It's in Acts, I think, chapter 31. Is it Acts 31? It's verse 31. And okay, I probably need to write it. Maybe it's there. 16, verse 31. In Acts chapter 16, verse 31, Paul and Silas are in prison, and then the God, things happened, asked, he said, "What do I need to do to be saved?" The most important question that any human being can ever ask, what do I need to do? They looked him in the eye and said, "Believe. Then you and maybe your whole household can be saved. Then all of you guys can spend," he didn't say, done with my quote, "then all of you and your family can spend time together, eternity with God." That's why it's so important for someone in the family to believe. Because if one believes, he will tell the other one, and probably tell the children, and the family will belong to God, and they will together journey forward to this amazing celebration, the banquet in heaven that we're now going to symbolize as we have communion. Let's move into communion.